Thank you all very much for coming out tonight during the rain. And thank you for letting us run a little bit late to give those who are stuck in traffic a little bit of a chance to get here. Tonight we have Mark Kingdon. We'll dive into his story, his experiences, his investments, a little bit about what he's observed as an investor, as a CEO, and trying to mine his mind for some tips on maybe some mistakes that he's seen made, some successes that he's seen made. And for those of you who's your first time here, we do a 45-minute interview called Fireside Chat, and then we open it up to a 15-minute Q&A. It's just kind of flowing, and we run over that hour, we might run over that hour. Once we run over the hour, we've got to sneak out, especially since we started late, and we completely understand. I want to say thank you to some of our sponsors. First of all, Google for Entrepreneurs. They're our global sponsor for Startup Run. Startup Run is active in about 175 cities. Miami was number 64, I believe, 63, 64. And we started this about 18 months ago, last May. It's just growing and growing, and thank you all for coming out and supporting us. This is our first time that we work. We try to do a little bit of a tour of the different co-working spaces around Miami, places that you might set up shop, and give you guys some exposure to that. We are also supported by the Knight Foundation. If you guys don't know about the Knight Foundation, if you like things like this, if you like what's happening right now in Miami in this space, you can number one, thank the Knight Foundation. Number two, check them out and get on our newsletter. They're going to let you know about other things like this that are going on. For example, Refresh Miami is one of the originals here in Miami, and they're also backed by the Knight Foundation. Right now, also backed by the Knight Foundation, is Tech Week. Miami Tech Week's going on, so this whole week is packed with events. There are four or five other events going on tonight in the same space. When we started this, it was us and Refresh Miami. And already in 18 months, we've got multiple events going on each week, and that's great because it used to be just two events per month. So just even tracking this community over the past 18 months, I've seen quite a bit of growth. We're also, like to say, give a shout out to Clutch Prep. Alex Nucci, that works at Clutch Prep, is a volunteer of ours. They operate out of building that code. Buildings where we had our heads the past 2 months. Miami has become, I guess we've always been, a big enough city to have our own TLD, top level domain. So now we have .miami domains. So instead of .com, you can have startupgrind.miami. And that's where we live. So if you ever want to find us, you can find us at startupgrind.miami. And we are also sponsored by hello.miami. So, do I have anyone here from hello.miami tonight to represent?
Yeah,
great. We're going to have David come up for Movie Picture. Movie Picture handles all of our video production, equipment, post-production, the whole nine yards, and everything seen tonight, everything that we do ends up on YouTube. You can go to startupgrind.miami, flip through to any of the speakers' pictures, and check out the videos, and that's the things that did.
Thanks, Jason. I'll be quick. Movie Picture Media creates original content for companies like Apple University, PwC, and Harley-Davidson. We can take your unique story, blend with business goals, and create meaningful content that will drive sales. So if anybody would like to speak about video production after the talk, come see me. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the support. And WeWork is graceful enough to bring us into their home today. Gives us a space, totally reconfigure this over desk here and lots of places to sit down earlier. And they totally flipped the world upside down to make room for us. So I'd like to give Anna just a minute here to tell you about the move.
We'd love to give you a tour, we'd love to show you our space, ask around.
start with a 45-minute interview, go into a 15-minute Q&A. Please raise your hand for the Q&A. Let's not hop over each other, and let's focus on questions, not rants. All right, so with further ado, let's give Mark a standing ovation.
Some form of traction. Like, is it, you know, resonating with consumers? Is it, you know, is it if it's an e-commerce site, is it getting repeat usage? Are the unit economics good because people like it? So I'm looking for traction and if at all possible, especially in e-commerce and unit economics.
Gotcha. And do you just stop reading the minute that you realize it's not in your category?
No, I read. I mean, I read fast. I took an Evelyn Wood class when I was in like sixth grade. Evelyn Wood reading dynamics and being able to speed reading. Yep. So I'm a fast reader, and I read everything.
And do you sometimes pass opportunities along the way? It's not my category, but it's
yes, good. Sometimes. I mean, I get a lot of junk, so I usually pass it to the trash pile. But sometimes I will pass things along to other investors and say, this isn't for me, but maybe it's for you. Then often, you know, funny thing about investors is when they get messages like that, it's like saying, it's like being in a focus group. And you say, you know, I wouldn't buy it, but it'd make a great gift.
Yeah.
Whoever's doing a focus group is very suspicious when they heard the gift. I wouldn't buy it, but maybe you'd like it. So
I'm going to play right off of that. I think I've heard plenty of sharks on Shark Tank say, I'm not an investor, but I'm a customer.
Okay.
Or maybe it's I'm invested in something that's a competitor, or maybe one day could be a competitor. They kind of seem like cop-outs.
Yeah, probably.
How can we get an investor to really just tell you the truth?
Ask them. Give them permission to dish your startup. Right, I mean, I think oftentimes, and I find myself falling into this trap, which is I want to give a graceful no. I also want to give kind of like a low intensity no. Because sometimes if you leave the door open, people want a lot of advice, and then there are 15 more emails on the no, and all of a sudden you know, you're doing this consulting project on the startup, and all you really wanted to say was no, and move on to the next thing.
Yeah.
I try to be a nice guy, and I try to give back. So a lot of times you'll get from investors kind of headaches. You're like, oh, it's a conflict. So that's kind of inarguable. It's like, well, I'm not going to change my mind if it's a conflict.
Right.
Or it's not in my category is a really easy no too. And so you'll get investors who will do that because it's just an easier letdown.
Gotcha.
But I think if you give them permission, you say, please just hit me with all you've got. I love your opinion. That's valuable. Oftentimes, what's wrong with your startup? And you should listen because they've seen everything 1,000 times.
And I'm sure there's a range that varies, but what size investments are you looking to make, and about what's a pre-money valuation range that you're looking for?
Sure. I write $50,000 to $250,000 checks. $50,000 to $250,000 checks. I mean, I think I've written one or two that are smaller than that, but for the most part, it's $50,000 to $250,000. And I typically, if the company is doing well, we'll do a follow-on investment, like Sketchy is an example. I'm writing my second check to Sketchy. So $50,000 to $250,000. And valuations are all over the board. It really depends on the company traction. But I will tell you, in the recent months, the valuations have gotten, over the last year, have gotten silly. Like, I talked to a company last week, this is the second in a few weeks that I've talked to. Pre-revenue, pre-product, the product doesn't launch until summer. And I said, well, what's the valuation? Well, what we were going to do an uncapped note, which is like crazy, but we decided to put a cap on it, and the cap is $15 million. So it's a pre-product, obviously pre-revenue. It's an idea and a dream, and it's a $15 million. You know, I chose, I gasped, I sputtered, and I said, no, thank you. It's crazy.
You start to choke at 5?
What's that?
You start to choke at 5?
No, I start to choke at 7.5. I start to take a deep breath at 7.5. At 10, I swallow hard. At 12, I choke. Look at about probably 1,500 companies a year, and that's things that come to me and then things that I look at. I do a lot of desk research. So when I'm interested in a category, I spend a lot of time with Adamar and TechCrunch and AngelList looking at the category to see who's new, what's coming out, and what they're doing. So through that process, plus all the inbound stuff I get, I look at about 1,500 companies a year. I try to speak to, and it varies wildly. Quiet week would be talking to 3 founders. A busy week would be talking to, let's say, 8 founders. So that's what a week looks like. And then at the end of the day, I write 3 to 5 checks a year.
Gotcha. And how do you find these people with your
list? A lot come to me inbound. So I'm going to give you one example, a little case study of kind of some good and bad investments that I made all at the same time, to give you kind of a sense of how it works. A lot of people think that this is a very transactional business. You get a deal, it's a yes or no, you move on. I think it's different. I think it's very karmic. So I think, you know, you put yourself out there, and I think the universe delivers you opportunities. And I'll give you an example. So this founder wrote me this really wacky note about this company called Nifty Thrifty, which was basically an online thrift store. Right? And it's from a clothing recycler for $1 and sell them for $40 a month. So I love the founder. I had no experience. He never had a real job. My due diligence was talking to his father to be sure he wasn't pregnant. I said, you know, let me talk to one of your professors. Let me go talk to your dad. I had lunch with his dad. I'm like, okay, so good. Like, I'm going to write in this check. Will he be here tomorrow? So it was one of those situations. So I wrote him a check. And I ended up writing the biggest checks that I've ever written to Nifty Thrifty. We raised $2 million. We lost it. All in kind of used clothing space. But as I did that, I got another inbound opportunity, and it was one of the most poorly written emails I've ever gotten from the founder. I'm going to frame it and then I'm going to check the exercise. From OfferUp, from the founder of OfferUp. It wasn't a great email, but I was really into used goods, and OfferUp is all about used goods. It's a used goods marketplace. So I said, you know, I'm going to be in Seattle for this Nifty Thrifty meeting. Let me meet this founder from OfferUp. I met him. I liked him. I wrote him a check. And I think it'll be a bigger return for me than I even had from Twitter to come with. So great opportunity. Then I was on AngelList one day, and I'm like, I really like this used goods thing. So I'm like, well, I looked at the low end, which is Nifty Thrifty. Let me look at the high end. So I found this great marketplace called The Real Real. I didn't mention this one of my most famous companies, but it will be a very famous company, I think. And I met the founder. Do you guys remember Pets.com, you know, the song about it? Okay, so the founder of that company, which is one of the dot-com era's biggest failures, a woman who's 57, founded a company called The Real Real. A woman buys an Hermes bag. It's not just women, men also. Sign on the Real Real, but it's largely women. Buys $15,000 Hermes bag, wears it a few times. I mean, what do you do with it? It's a high price problem. So she calls the Real Real. We send it to stylist over. She picks up the handbag. We photograph it, put it on the website, sell it for $15,000, and pay 30% of the transaction. So when I met Julie, she was doing $80,000 a month, and now she does about $80,000 in 3 hours. This is 4 years later. So she's $210 million this year in revenue. So I found that company because I was interested in used goods. Why? Because I wrote a whopper of a check to Nifty Thrifty, which I lost, and I wrote another.
And in your mind, what are the probabilities?
Well, I'm in 24 companies. I have one death unicorn, which is Twitter. I've had one unicorn, which is Bat, which I was not able to cash out on before it went to less than unicorn status. I think that OfferUp will be a third unicorn, very shortly, actually. And then I think the chances for the real are super. So if I can have 4 or 5 home runs out of 24, I'm definitely getting the average.
Yeah, absolutely. That'd be really good. And if somebody refers a deal to you, does it jump to the top of your stack, or do you kind of just think of it?
If it's in my, I'm a little bit of a contrarian. And I will say that, and this is an odd thing to say, a referral isn't a bad thing. And I think in the venture capital industry, referrals are like gold. For me, they're like fool's gold. Meaning, I don't attribute any more weight to a referral than I do to something I found on my own, because I really trust my gut. And one of the reasons I haven't taken capital from anyone else is I don't want anyone or anything influencing my decision. I want it to be pure and clear.
And do you ever,
say what very fancy rebranding of fucking colossal failure, right? I mean, it's true. So it's sort of like, I have to love the idea, and I have to really like the better. And when I say love, I have to just like love. If I go to bed at night and I'm not thinking about that company, it's like, even if I feel like I should write a check, if I'm not feeling that thing, then I don't write the check.
All right.
You are artistic. I've seen your sketches. Can we coin that? They're a good point, I'm sure. So I've seen your sketches, and on sketches you draw pictures of other people that they've uploaded, and they've been inspired by those pictures, and it seems martial on some pictures. So I've seen your sketches. At some point you decide to make your creative side of the body and focus on management consultant, a very structured career. What point did that happen? Should you remember it happened?
Absolutely. From the time I was 6 years old, I wanted to be an artist. And my parents were wonderful. They encouraged me to pursue my love, which was art. So I went to college, I went to UCLA. I was a fine arts major as a teacher. I also studied art history. And then, and I went to Parsons School of Design in New York. So I had a good thing going, I had a great portfolio. And then by my junior year, I started to realize that I was totally unemployable. My parents said, this gravy train is not going to last forever, right? So I changed it. So I had a friend, actually, who had gone to the University of Pennsylvania, was at UCLA. He said, you're really analytical. Like, if you look at your art, it's very analytical. And it was very kind of painful and analytical. He said, and you're good at economics. So I assumed in economics, I got really great grades. He said, you should consider it for your business. So I switched my major to economics. And I did really well. This is UCLA undergrad. And then he had gone to the University of Pennsylvania before. And he said, you should apply to business school. And so I did. And I got into a great business school. I was the youngest person in my class. It was a little bit weird. And I went to business school. And when you're in business school, you don't know what you're going to do with your life. That's like a no commitment career. That means I don't know what I'm going to do, but I'm going to go do a lot of different things. So I became a manager consultant. I was a partner at PricewaterhouseCoopers for 12 years. It was awesome.
And you described that time of your life as being fast track or a partnership.
It was, yes. I was the youngest or second youngest main partner in consulting, depending on how you define time of entry. It was either me or my friend Bill Patina. Yes.
And what do you think got you on the short list for that? Do you think coming out of Wharton with your MBA helped quite a bit?
I'll tell you what I think. I was a good thinker, and I was very good at problem. We used to joke, this is a little bit of a joke, but my slide productivity for however deep everybody else is in hell, I can produce more smart, fast slides than anybody else. I think that was it. It's like, I'm still really good. I can get a deck out, in a part.
It still happens.
Yeah, I was also good at photocopy machine.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can photocopy
that. Yeah. Don't need to do it so much anymore because we use PDFs.
Yeah.
It's good.
Good stuff. The time that you were there, I think in a small period of a couple of years, PwC went from 250 million to 1.2
million. Yeah, that's just one practice area within the consulting business. Yeah, so it was the kind of the internet consulting. I was one of the four global leaders in the firm. 250 million to 1.2 or 1.3 billion in an extremely short period of time. We were hiring, we measured the number of people we were hiring for these firms.
And how does a management consulting firm plan and execute on that?
Meticulously. It was a fantastic firm, hyper-organized. Everything was, codified and
ran on the machine. Was it a set goal? 2 years?
Yes. We had very, very concrete goals that we, longer term goals that we just aggregated into quarterly plans.
Okay. So you start hard backwards?
Yep.
Break it down from
there. Absolutely.
Okay. And then from there you went on to be an entrepreneur in residence at Neola.
Yes. So I did the pre-merger planning and post-merger integration for the merger of PricewaterhouseCoopers, a big professional service firm.
idea lab came overture search, which
the
came
toys, yeah. An overture tool it became keyword buying, which is basically what Google is based on.
Yeah, Google AdWords.
Yeah.
And that's where Google made stuff.
Because 90% of the revenue. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. And what do you do there as an entrepreneur residence, and is that title always carry the same set of responsibilities, or do you need to your own skills?
Well, I think that's one of those jobs that's kind of like you're a smart guy, we don't know what to call you, pardon me, or precisely what you're going to do, but we'd like to have you in the organization. So come in and try to do something smart for us. And so I have the honor and privilege of working with Bill Gross, who's absolutely one of the most brilliant people on the planet. Howard Morgan is another great and early stage venture capitalist. And basically what I did, because this was the time, you know, I joined just before the bubble burst, and Bill Gross gave a speech that said IdeaLab could be the first $1 trillion market cap company, which anytime someone says that to you, you know you're kind of in a bubblicious environment. So he gave that speech, and then a few weeks later, the market crashed. And so I spent my time there helping them kind of rationalize the e-commerce portfolio, make sense of the investments that they'd already made.
And then from there, you go on to...
Yeah, well, then I kind of figured out that, and you know, Bill told me, he said, you know, you can stay forever because we love you, but, you know, no one's investing in companies. I mean, this is 2000, so if you want to do more than you're doing now, you know, you probably need to find something else to do. But stay as long as you'd like, you can stay forever. So I said, well, I should probably get a real job. So I had a dream of being CEO before I was 40. You know, you have a little bucket list, that was one of my bucket list things. So I got recruited to be the CEO of a company called Organic, which was Organic placed the first banner ad in the internet history. You can go to Wikipedia and look it up. So one of the earliest pioneers in digital advertising and website development. So the CEO had decided, just, you know, stock price had gone from $60 to like whatever it was when I joined the dollar. He's like, no, maybe we need to get a different CEO. So he hired me, the board hired me to be the CEO. And so I was hired to reposition and turn around.
And what does it take for a CEO to step down? Was that number one?
Courage. You know, I've replaced two CEOs who step down, and I will say I have immense respect for both of them because they went through a long process of recognizing that the job had evolved, that perhaps their skills were either not what they needed to be, or that the job required things that they didn't want to do. And that takes a lot of self-awareness and self-discovery.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you went into Oregon, the stock had gone from 60 to
a dollar. Billions of dollars of work. Yes.
Yeah. And then you took back off the exchange, right?
Yes, we did. We took it private with private equity money. We bought out all the public shareholders, and then we, you know, very aggressively restructured the company, got its profitability, and then once it was doing better, we sold it to Hong Kong, which is one of the big global holding companies. And stayed there for 8 years.
Okay. You walk in the door, the first day of Organic. Who's the first person you want to talk to? Who's the first one you ask?
Wow, that's a great question.
What's on the list?
No. I'm thinking you're taking me back like a long time. You're taking me back 15 years. Who's the first person that I saw and wanted to speak to? Well, it was the CFO, and I wanted to know what the latest sales projection was. Actually, yes.
And what's the reason for taking the company back private?
Because I knew that we had to go through a gut-wrenching restructuring, and when you're a public company, you have to get on a quarterly call, because I was on a bunch of quarterly calls, and they were really hard. We were in a client service business, and so when you have to get on a public call that your clients listen to, when you have to talk about all the shit that's going wrong in your company, it doesn't exactly instill confidence in your customers. So, you know, the first thing I said to the board is, we are not going to get through this restructuring unless, you know, we're outside of kind of the public scrutiny and can do this behind closed doors.
then when you were there, you had a shiny objects chaser.
Yes, yeah. I did. His name's Chad.
And once in a while, Chad would strike gold. Yeah. But the smaller organization, 10, 20 people, where you can't have a dedicated shiny objects person, how have you seen small groups value shiny objects and not get too distracted from it, but at the same time not miss the opportunity?
Okay. So what he means by shiny objects are those kind of really innovative, interesting, big ideas that are, you know, maybe super early and don't fit with the company. So, pardon me. I love shiny objects. And we were in a professional services business. We were a digital agency, and all of our clients were like Bank of America, Dodge, Chrysler. And, you know, they want to see kind of the newest, latest, greatest thing. No, not a dollar spent on that new greatest thing, but still, to be fresh and to be unique, we need to get that shiny object in our market. And so I hired a shiny objects person. I love shiny objects, so I was really the shiny objects person, but I had nothing to do, so I couldn't have that job. So I hired a shiny objects guy, and I had a couple of people. One's name was Sean, another was Jack. I said, look, you guys just look for shiny objects and bring them forward, share them with the team. Try to work them into the work, try to integrate them into the company, and let's do stuff with them.
Gotcha, gotcha. And speaking of new, innovative VR, virtual reality.
Oh, yes.
It's taking off, and with Oculus, obviously.
Indeed.
Do you think Google Cardboard was a slap in Facebook space?
Oh, those guys are always slapping at each other. Yeah, maybe. Maybe, although maybe that thing is really going to work hard. You know, I mean, I worked in virtual reality. I was the CEO of Santa Clara for 2 years, which is, you know, one of the biggest, you know, destinations if you're into virtual reality. I loved it. It's rich, deeply immersive. It's also not the biggest audience in the world. So I have a lot of questions about kind of the, you know, the mass potential for virtual reality. A lot of questions. I mean, I just don't know if people are going to like wear boxes.
You were at Second Life doing $500 million a year in transaction of
digital money.
Yeah, right. Digital money. Where are they at now?
The company is still extremely successful and extremely profitable. When I left in 2010, we were doing $500 million in user-to-user transactions. I don't think it's wildly higher, but I don't think it's wildly lower than that today.
Do you think
that's a very poor user base?
Do you think this adoption of VR could spike quite a bit?
I think it could. Second Life is a very specific, you know, is a very specific experience and application that isn't necessarily, you know, extensible in a way that you might think, but it certainly has brought a lot more attention to Second Life, because Second Life was the largest scale pioneer in virtual reality. And if you haven't been, it's a magnificent place. Really spectacular.
Nice. And you're obviously CEO of Second Life. We've got VR, publicly traded marketing ad agency, but neither of those two are your investment categories.
Yeah, so I hate advertising. I love advertising. A bunch of my startups are fully dependent on advertising, but I hate it. When I joined Organic, I thought we were a technology company that built websites, but it turned out that the market collapsed for back-end development, and all the money was in the marketing department. So I pivoted. Okay, I pivoted the company from back-end development to front-end design and digital marketing. Thank God I did, because all our competitors continued to crash. But I went from a business I liked, which is, you know, tech, to one that I didn't, which was advertising. I stuck it out for 8 years, and I left, and I haven't looked back.
And then VR?
VR, you know, I'm waiting. VR is hard, because right now we need to establish the operating system for virtual. Right, that's what Google and Facebook trying to create the operating system. I think that's very hard. I would leave that out to them. I think think once the operating system is established, there will be a lot of opportunities to build applications on those operating systems. And I think that's what I'm waiting for,
really.
I'm waiting to see which operating system wins and then what applications will be built on that. That's where the excitement, in my mind, from the investment perspective.
Okay, so you're not going to invest in OS, but you may invest in some actions, the foundations there.
Yep.
And what's the 20 startups, 24 startups actually said invested in today. Would you ever go back to being the CEO again?
Absolutely not. it's too much work. I did it, I wanted to do it. I think I did a decent job at it, but absolutely not.
And of these 24 startups, you think about the ones that you don't lose sleep over too often. You feel really comfortable. You hope that they might come back for a follow-on round. You're waiting for that phone call.
Yeah.
How do those founders handle the investor relationship?
It all depends. You know, it all depends. The best founders are the founders that keep their investors up to date. So I think when I see a founder I think he's doing a great job. They're sending regular updates to the investors. And I think that's good for two reasons. One, because it's a discipline for the founder to really take a step back every month and say, how am I really doing? And then to kind of report out to investors. I think that's a very, very good discipline. I like to see that. That's something I think is amazing. I have founders that don't do that. I have founders that, like, you know, kind of take the check. And we'll take the call when you call for an update and give you the update, kind of semi-begrudgingly. And you know, I'm not so thrilled about that. Because you know, I mean, I wrote him a check, maybe not a huge amount of money, but you know, it would have gotten started if a few of us had to but for them to climb up some different checks.
And somebody that's like that, they kind of dark out on you.
Yeah.
Maybe they're doing a little bit better trajectory-wise and something that keeps you informed.
Very insightful. That there is a bit of an inverse relationship between information and performance. But nevertheless, I still like to see the information.
So the performance low, that might not be forthcoming with information. But what's it?
Or sometimes when the performance is really high, they're like, ah, shit, it's all going well. Trust me, it's going well. That's why I said inverse relationship. Sometimes when you're hearing a lot from the and sometimes when you're not hearing from them, it's because you're really
wrong. So do you hold it against them an opportunity for a follow-on round?
What's that?
Do you hold that against them an opportunity for a follow-on round? Never are they well.
Well, listen, there are two kinds of follow-on rounds. Okay. There's the follow-on round that where we're doing really well. We're going down for a series, you know, A or kind of a series C plus. It's a higher valuation, things are go, we're oversubscribed, but we'll still take their money. That's one kind of check. A lot of times what you're getting in your follow-on round is more like, coming back to you guys, you know, we're kind of sort of making some progress, you can see a little bit of traction, but we're really not ready for that Series A, but we'd be great if you investors could write another check.
Do you hear put more money in or your original investment is gone?
No one ever threatens that, and that's no reason to invest. I was an econ teacher, and they teach one thing in economics, which is the theory of sunk cost. So once you've written that check, it's a sunk cost. There's one thing I learned in economics, once you've written that check, it's gone. So for me, it's like that's no reason to reinvest.
Gotcha.
Okay. Yeah.
Never must be, but you know the wrong reasons.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if let me refer to if you were to straddle two companies like Jack Dorsey's doing right now with Twitter and Square,
yeah.
And you did go back and become CEO and you had two companies at one, would you, or who would you have reporting directly to you? With what information and how often?
Okay, great question. First of all, I love Jack Dorsey. I mean, he, I think, is a product genius. He did a phenomenal job with Twitter. Obviously, invested in him and his idea. I think he did a phenomenal job with Square, I think he's great. I think you can run two companies, because if you have built a strong and robust team, then creation of fully armed management by marketing and operations. So, and if those are mature teams, then they report it to you. Talk to your team every day, and they should really only bring you things of exceptional importance. You should be focused on strategy, vision, and bringing money into you. And I think Jack can be back a little bit on this as well.
Do you think Jack knew that they were going to change the pay button to a little heart bonus?
I have no idea, but I do like it. And supposedly it's boosted engagement.
That's
it's a little dazzle.
I'm just
it's a small thing, but you know.
Yeah, I'm wondering if he's hearing about those little things. That could make a big difference way up there.
Good question, I have no idea. Well, there's so little interface in Twitter, he probably hears about everything.
It's true.
Right? I mean, Twitter has like almost no interface.
And you invested in Twitter right after a major pivot.
Yes, there's.
What were they before they were
focused on? It was Odepod. It was this podcasting thing that they built, and it wasn't working. And so they offered money back to their investors, and then Jack kind of as a side project created this thing.
So some of the investors, do they
have some of them, you know, if you ask me a name, I can't remember who, but some of them took their money back and some rolled forward.
Okay. And you got in right at that?
I got in right at that.
Awesome. And then Fab.com, that goes from being the seed stage to $1 billion investment. What were the pivots that you wanted to originally invest in?
Okay, so I invested, well, this is an interesting case. So I invested in a friend, Jason Goldberg. He had done a company called Jobster, which I really admired. He was a job seeker. And then he created a gay social network. And because I was doing social networking stuff, the deal was referred to me as a referral. And I talked to Jason, I really liked him. Not a bad idea, just not a really big idea. But I wrote a check, which is one of my early investments. A year in, he figured out that it really wasn't working because, you know, Facebook was taking off, so we need a gay social network when you have kind of a meta social network. Well, one thing that was really working on Fab was the sale of t-shirts and merchandise. So he's like, wow, so my audience really likes t-shirts, and all of a sudden, I'm like, well, I'm going to go to commerce center. And it's bad. So Fab blew up into this $1 billion colossus. And then, you know, they figured out that, you know, maybe the business model wasn't working as well as it needed to. So Jason looked at one product category, home furnishings, that was doing really, really well, and said, you know what, we're going to forget about this thing called Fab.com, and we're going to build Him.com, which is home furnishings. So we're going to be a full stack of home furnishings, you know, design and reselling. And that is the current configuration of Fab.
So a couple of pivots, three different versions of the company.
And
three names.
$100 million.
But like failures, pivots are somewhat oddly celebrated. To me, someone's like,
yeah,
being a born again or something. It's like, what's wrong? I'm right. Yeah.
It's failure rebranded. But sometimes you can, you know, fail fast and succeed faster, right? So that's kind of this lean startup motto. It's not a bad thing. I think we just shouldn't, you know, we shouldn't be pivot crazy. And we shouldn't look at, you know, if you have an idea that's not working, you need to change it. So there's no crime in admitting failure and moving on. I just think that pivots are really expensive. And we can't forget that they're a failure.
Is there any calculus that you use to like kind of measure the opportunity cost of a pivot? We put X number of dollars in that equates to X percent of our market potential, and we've invested so much, time to move on.
That's a great question, and I'm an analytical guy. I guess you would think I would, but no. I mean, I kind of just, I look at pivot, I look at how far we've come. I think about, you know, what makes sense as a next step, what the core competencies of the organization are, and if, you know, if there's something you can work with, then I hope that the pattern moves on and works with it. But I haven't really done any kind of economic calculation.
Gotcha. So it's not that
It's very soft.
Let's talk about the name of your company.
Okay.
What's the name of your
Quixotic Ventures.
And why?
Well, because it's like, you feel like you're tilting at windmills. You feel like a madman that's tilting at windmills. Because, I think my most successful companies are companies if people thought were ridiculous. Twitter, exactly having an easy time raising money. I had famous venture capitalists that would tell me, because it was one of my earliest investments that was a bad idea. Thank God I didn't listen to them. And, so you feel like, you're alone and you're a little crazy. At least that's me. So I felt like it was perfect for me.
Right. And if you say no to somebody, but you don't give them a hard no, or it's not my category, or it's just not the right time. Right. Do you like those founders to keep in touch with you?
I do. Especially if it's something I was on the fence with, I want to continue to hear about. Because, sometimes it really is the case where it looks promising, but there just isn't enough kind of proof or traction. And the truth is, today it costs so little to get an app out in the App Store so that you can gauge customer traction. So I expect to see something happening. And if there isn't something happening, but I still feel good about the company, I want to hear about it again.
Okay, and do you sign NDAs?
Never sign. People sometimes ask, and I just roll my eyes, there's nobody in the venture industry who signs an NDA. It's like the most ridiculous kind of sophomore question you get ever asked. Are you kidding?
So you don't
sign an NDA. Well, actually, you asked me a question. When I get stuff in, that goes right in the trash. And it's like, I get these write-ins, people say, I have this phenomenal idea. Here's an NDA, sign it, and I'll tell you about the idea. Drag and drop, right in the trash.
Easy filter there.
Yeah.
So you don't sign an NDA, but maybe they're going to keep you up to date. Is it a good idea if they're just enroll you in their investor updates, or is that just too much information?
That's probably too much information. I mean, I think it's what you do. I think what you want to do, let's just say that you pitch somebody, and they kind of you have the feeling like they're kind of interested, but they couldn't write a check. Wait until you actually have some really good news to share that shows positive traction, positive momentum, and keep them apprised when it happens. I admire founders who do that. And there are a couple that pitched me in Miami that have done very well. I think that's an admirable quality that speaks to them as well.
Awesome. And you touched on it earlier, but at the end of the pitch, you're just sitting there thinking, that was a waste of my time. Are you Mr. Nice Guy or Mr. Wonderful?
I like to think I'm never an asshole. Because it's like, it would be really devastating to me if someone thought I was an asshole because I really worked hard all my life and I couldn't be an asshole. I'm happy to give candid feedback. Sometimes it's less than useful though, because sometimes it's just a feeling. I'm like, it's not very gratifying when you say to a founder, I don't feel it. It's like, I don't see how the market size is big enough, or I just don't know how this is going to resonate with consumers. I'm just not feeling any good about it. Not very actionable. But, that's what it is. That's what I'll share. But oftentimes I'm analytical. I'll have some concrete. I'll be like, yeah, the repeat rate sucks. I mean, yeah, people are buying your product, but they're not buying it a second time. So get the repeat rate better. Get the repeat rate up. Sometimes it'll be actionable.
And you mentioned some resources. You're on TechCrunch.
Yes.
You're on AngelList.
Yes.
You mentioned the third analyzing companies and friends.
Oh, Mattermark.
Mattermark. Any other books, blogs that you follow? Any advice in the direction?
Oh, well, I love Fred Wilson at ABC. I read Mark's sister's blog. I read every tweet that Mark Andreessen puts out there. So I follow, probably the most popular VC fund on Twitter, the most common bloggers, like everyone else. And that's how I do it.
Gotcha. We're going to open it up for Q&A.
Wonderful.
So, Dan, we've got any questions?
questions? Yeah, right here.
Let's speak very loud.
Do you ever have any questions about the game app?
You know, I get a lot of it. No. You know, the thing is I'm not really a game. I have to do what I love, but I'm not a game app. And it's a hits business, and I don't know how to find it. I'm good at finding hits, but not outside my category.
So my question is around valuations. You know, typically when you're going through the process of creating product, acquiring customers, there's one thing about how you price your product and how that leads to like a valuation based on potential revenue and stuff. Can you give some ideas around what you've seen? How do people go about mapping that process?
You know, I think in categories where valuations are determined by revenue, there are benchmarks like in SaaS. I have a couple of SaaS investments. And you know, the revenue multiple varies based on level of size of the company, level of growth. It might be 5, 6, 7, 8x revenue. E-commerce can be, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 times revenue. So for businesses like e-commerce and SaaS, you can kind of work your way up to a valuation range.
Right.
But for most startups, it's like, you know, spaghetti. It's, the valuation is whatever you can get an investor to pay.
Correct.
So if you're trying to raise money, make it an option. Try to get as many people as excited as possible. Get competing term sheets and see if you can get your valuation.
I got you.
Up front, yeah.
So you know, now it's all about smart money. Perhaps when you started as an investor, people didn't reward. How could you position yourself as an investor, get into that round, and perhaps without not having the qualifications that your entrepreneur might want, how could you have that value?
That's a great question. I mean, I think that everybody respects ingenuity and creativity. So I think if you can find a creative way to get have something to bring to the table, whether it's domain expertise or industry contacts or something. I think entrepreneurs are always looking for creative people to bring into the mix. And I have seen really unlikely people get on kind of the investor list for hot startups simply because they made the call and they pushed hard.
And you're getting Twitter, did you know the founder?
Oh, Twitter, well, okay, so I'll tell you the Twitter story. You know, I was running a big digital agency, one of the most important digital agencies, you know, of the era. And, you know, we had clients like Dodge, Jeep, Chrysler, a bunch of others. And Twitter had just launched. Jeep was one of my kind of pet clients. And I thought, wow, there's this Jeep group that goes off-road. These off-roading adventures, that would be so cool. They could do like little status updates, like I'm on Rock 104 meeting for a year. Another way you could do that is for your mobile phone, right? And so I thought, oh, that would be for Twitter, it just launched, and I thought, well, that would be a great idea. So I called them on the phone, I spoke to this phone, I said, Vince, you know, I have this like $40 million budget, I have all this money, let me write you a check, build this thing for me, for Jeep, and you know, listen, I had a lot of marketing dollars to spend. And you know, he took a meeting and he's like, that's really interesting. Yeah, you really have a cool application. And he called me back and he said, you know, Mark, this thing Twitter, really, you know, we just launched it, it doesn't really work. And so if we do this thing for you, for G, then we're never going to focus on this thing called Twitter and make it work. So he said, no. So I said, wow. And so a few weeks later, I called him back. I said, I'm still thinking about it. I really like it. But you guys, I have some money, I'll and I'm like, this was my third investment. You know, I had just started investing like 18 months before. So he's like, okay. So I wrote him a check. And it was good to see you.
Hi.
Yes.
If you had to give someone some advice about building a pitch for you, what are the things that you're looking for in the presentation?
Well, I'll tell you, flattery always works. No, I'm joking. know your audience and try to understand why your pitch would be relevant to them. And that's the comment about the letter. So the first thing is make sure you say in the opening paragraph why it's not a waste of time for them to read your email. Like, you know, no one wants to get like spammy pitches. So really think about who you're reaching out to. And think about why, other than the fact that they have a checkbook, you might actually want their money. And then I think the pitch is just, the product has to speak for itself. I was the second investor in Sketchy. And Jordan had built a stunning, do not leave without him. It's gorgeous, it's 5-star rating in the App Store with a bunch of ratings, which is unheard of. And the product spoke for itself. Jordan was a good pitch guy, but the product spoke for itself. So make sure you actually have something that speaks for itself, because I think those are the best pitches, and something speaks for itself. You have much higher rate of success.
Yes. So in terms of like you're getting a pitch from an outbound pitch, opening the email,
yep.
Explaining first the thing why we are not wasting your time, but what is like top three things that we shouldn't miss about pitching? Okay, I clearly get that traction from one of those key elements that you want to see, like how we use those traction. But that would be like one second, right?
Yeah, it's creative, right? I mean, I've got to sense your passion and excitement. I've got to sense why it's unique or different. I also, for me, I like to buy. I don't like to be sold to. So if it feels like a pitch where I'm being sold to, that's it. But if it feels like something where you're presenting, intelligently presenting something that I might be interested in buying, then I'm much more, that's personal, that's for me. But I think that's, know your audience. Tell them something interesting. Tell them something unexpected. I got a pitch that I'm still thinking about. I'll never write a check to this company because it's not in my space. But the guy wrote this whole paragraph in there about love. So I thought, well, this must be a dating app. It must be like a good karma app. I'm like, okay. And it was like some boring, super boring thing that had nothing to do with love. And I was like, you know, I was like, yeah, I read it. His wife was in such dribble that it cuts through and has. So don't have just a love paragraph in your notebook. Be thoughtful. Try to stand out because investors, if they're good investors, they get a lot of good money.
What would you say that is the kind of the balance, the percentage between the, in general, I mean, I'm speaking about the VC world in general, how much or how many idea stage projects VCs invest as opposed to having to have something like tangible and measurable, and as you were saying, with traction and with market size, again, as opposed to something that could be a good idea that meets the execution.
Okay. Well, first of all, if you're a first-time founder, and you're a first-time founder, you've never run a company before, maybe you want something that's interesting, you have an idea, you don't have a product, you just have a little pitch deck. I think that's a little bit harder. So we would call that pre-product, pre-revenue, pre-pitch. Right? Yeah. ERP, not a good thing. So I think that's a hard sell. But if you're an experienced entrepreneur, I just saw a pitch last week at a very high valuation. I elect not to write a check, but there's a point to write a check. But it was a very experienced entrepreneur. And so I think you're a very experienced entrepreneur with a track record, and you are pre-revenue, pre-product, pre-pitch, you can get it. So I think it's about you and your experience. People will buy open and drink, but if you don't have a little bit of track record, it's a harder sell.
I had a question about time management for entrepreneurs. So, I mean, you yourself and a CEO, you deal with a lot of entrepreneurs. What do you think are like two or three things where thinking about all the tasks that an entrepreneur needs to do? You've got vision, you want to pitch strategy, you want to go get investors, but you also want to manage HR and QA testing and your actual product. Like, what do you think is good balance, particularly when an entrepreneur is seeking money?
Okay, so I have a simple simple mantra I tell myself all the time. If you know Myers-Briggs, I'm an INTJ, which is a mastermind type. I'm thinking about everything all the time, so I'm a call micromanager. So I always reminded myself never to let the urgent crowd out the important. So I think one of the things is, as an entrepreneur and a founder, is that everything is urgent, right? Everything is urgent, but not necessarily important. And so I would try to sweep kind of the urgent stuff away and focus on what's important, which is the product vision, which is the user experience, which is kind of the customer traction, and, you know, at some point, like, you know, investor relations, because you're going to need money to, you know, power this beast. You know, it's sort of interesting. You would think that most pitches are kind of like the new thing, but oftentimes a lot of pitches are kind of the old thing, rebought for the umpteenth time. And so, I guess I'm seeing more VR stuff, which is why Jason asked the question, because VR is very hot. For a while, anything based on Bitcoin was hot. Second Life was the largest virtual currency in today, so I got a lot of Bitcoin I think Uberization is a trend. The kind of the on-demand economy is a really, really big trend, and it is being applied to every segment of life. I guess that's probably the big trend. You know, now you can Airbnb. And you know what? There are four startups doing Airbnbs on campus. I'm not a camper, but I've gotten every one of those pitches. It's like, really? How big is the total addressable market? You know, with it, on which thumbnail am I thinking of? Where am I thinking of? Little market.
Do you think somebody recently said to me that we're turning this country into an Uber economy? On-demand economy, disaggregated workers, no benefits. They don't even want you to work. They don't want you.
Yeah.
Is it a good thing or a bad thing?
You know, that's a really great question. I don't think it's a great thing. But I have kids, and listen, this is camera's rolling, so I have to be really careful about it. I'm worried. I'm really worried because. I had really great career experiences, and I spent 12 years at PricewaterhouseCoopers, and I learned more in those 12 years than I can learn in a lifetime. And that was being plugged in, starting as a point, literally making photocopies, and mapping up slides. As a matter of fact, my managing partner had this really strong British accent. I could never understand it, so I always knew he said, pack it up, take my slide, and mack it up. So that's what I did. Yeah.
accepted. I was shocked. I was like, wow, I don't work for a big company. I have to buy my own insurance. I bought it on the exchange. No one would take it. I said, why don't you take this insurance? Like, it's a bond here. It pays crap. We don't accept it. I'm like, you don't accept my insurance. First time in my life. So, you know, this on-demand economy is tough, and it's hard on the worker. Really hard on the worker.
Please keep an eye on your email box. Next week, I'm going to be sending you a pitch about an app called Map It Up, where I have people learn how to
do it. That's great. Yeah. Well, I'm good. It's just actually how I support myself. You don't know this. You know, I'm a fiver. I'm a freelancer.
And one more question. I'm back there.
Eric. Before we wrap it up, I'd like to say thank you to some of the people that helped me pull this together. Rita Dasenthal has helped me since day one and pulling this all together. And new to our volunteer team is Peter Kovac, who's back here, sitting by the bottom. And the folks here at WeWork for turning their house upside down and making room for us tonight. So, Mark, thank you so much for your time tonight. It's been very nice.